Good afternoon, everybody. I'd like to thank all the panelists on the stage for being here. So I think we have a little shortening of the time. We'll get about 40 minutes because we're running a bit behind in starting this session. I'd also like to thank FADA for inviting me here to moderate the session this afternoon. So I thought before we get on with some Q&A, I'd share a few opening thoughts around dealer profitability and what we're seeing in terms of future retail trends in automotive in India. Then I'd request the panelists to share some of their opening comments and perspectives around the impact that digital can have on dealer profitability. And then we'll have some time for Q&A, some questions that I have, and we'll open it up for questions from the audience as well. So just next, I think just looking at some of the key issues and trends in the industry today, financial performance, we know the last few years, particularly the Indian market, have been difficult, largely because of slowdown in volume and slowdown in growth. Second key trend is around digital proliferation. I don't need to talk more about that. I think that's what this whole day has been about since the morning. So you've got a good snapshot of various developments that are happening in India as we speak. And I think we've also heard that the pace of change is quite rapid. I think we're also seeing OEMs beginning to explore new channels, and we're entering an omni-channel world. Skill development and staff retention, is an issue that as dealers you deal with every day, and certainly an area of significant attention in the last couple of years, at least from the work that we're doing in the industry with some of you and with many others. And lastly, I think, is around customer experience. That's a term, again, that we've heard very often today in terms of how can you transform customer experience through through digital interventions. Next. So I'm not going to get too much into overall dealer profitability. I think there's enough data out there. But just some different aspects of dealer profitability that I wanted to highlight, which are probably not talked of as much, as compared to margin on new vehicle sales or service and parts revenues and margins. But I think the pre-owned car business is a potential opportunity for significant profit for all of you. At least from the work that we do in the industry, we don't see this being leveraged enough, or it's not as profitable as it should be. So clearly there's a significant opportunity here in pre-owned car profitability for the industry. Finance and leasing, if you see the various channels, whether it be NBFCs, banks, or captives, the dealer desk does play an important part in all these channels, and whether it be finance or insurance, I think there's significant upside that could be targeted over here. So just as an example, one of the dealer groups we're working with, their conversion on insurance renewals is insignificant. I mean, if they're just renewed 1,000 policies at, or 10,000 policies at, 10,000 rupees, that's 10 crores in the pocket right there, just 10,000 rupees of margin on that policy. I'm talking about a luxury, premium brand. So there is a lot of opportunity out there. I think it's a matter of bringing some additional focus into these profitability levers, particularly pre-owned cars, finance, insurance, and leasing, as possibly leasing will become more mainstream in the future. Next. So digital, I think I'm not going to go into all of this. We've been hearing a lot from Google and CarDekho through the day, but clearly the importance of digital, whether it be in terms of marketing spend or in terms of conversions through walk-ins and digital, I think that's definitely changing. Now, you know, how fast is the rate of adoption, I think, is something that waits to be seen, but clearly, from what I see, the pace is increasing as well and becoming much faster than what it was, say, 2 years ago. Next. In terms of new channels, I think we're seeing some early stages here with, you know, online partnerships, mobile showrooms, virtual showroom, and, you know, differentiate customer experience. So these are all examples of recent initiatives by OEMs in the new channel space. So this is, you know, creating obviously an implication for, you know, OEMs to have an omni-channel strategy. Also implications for dealers to be able to provide a similar customer experience or an equally good customer experience on a digital channel as compared to, you know, brick and mortar channel or a physical channel. So all of this, I think, is going to result in some new roles for sales, DSEs and other staff at the showroom, sales and service. I would throw a sort of futuristic thought out here, given what we've been hearing today, the kind of apps we've been seeing, and understanding that dealers don't really make a lot of money on new vehicle sales. A lot of it is passed on in incentives, and particularly that's been the case, and discounts over the last few years. That, you know, and 75% of customers are anyway doing their research, and as we've seen, there's potential to provide a much more consistent experience to the customer using, a digital interface. You don't miss out on anything. You communicate all the messages. It's updated regularly. You know, it's much more interactive now, and also you can track and have alerts sent to you and to the customers, so it's much more efficient. That why do we actually need a dealer sales executive going forward? You know, maybe the future we don't really have a dealer sales executive. A lot of this pre-sales comparison, quoting, etc., can be done online or through a digital channel. What we need is a transaction specialist, somebody that can close the deal, and we need a, you know, somebody that can manage the entire test drive experience. So all you have people coming in is to do a test drive, manage that efficiently, have a guy who's good at logistics management and organizing the test drives, and then you have a specialist who's just, you know, going to close the deal. He's a negotiator. He negotiates with the customer, closes the deal. So I'm just throwing that out there as a possibility that we should possibly seriously think about over the next 3 to 4 years as this whole digital intervention increases in the industry. Next, please. So I think in our view, there's a paradigm shift likely to happen in automotive retail overseas as well as in India. And I think we see that being built around 5 key pillars. Of course, you know, creating an engaging digital journey is one of them. But I think the other key elements are a focus on customer centricity, emergence of, you know, new business models and new value propositions. Third is redesigning distribution networks. And we talked about, you know, the multiple channels now that are emerging to reach customers. And lastly is having a seamless experience for your customers, no matter which channel they come through. And, it needs to be a seamless and high quality experience across all channels. So I think some of the other, enablers around this that probably haven't changed in the industry for a long time is when we're taking on these aspects of changing the customer experience or providing an engaging digital experience, is we need to design the process around the customer, not around the product and the showroom. Today, in the automotive industry, everything is designed around the showroom and the product. Well, that's not where your customers are, right? The customers are doing different things, and, you know, through digital now, we have the ability finally to design the process of selling a car or servicing a car or renewing an insurance around the customer. So let's go to where the customer is, see what he's doing, and design the process customer backwards, not product outwards. The second key aspect that's missing in industry today, I think, is customer lifecycle management. And these are specific things I'm talking about India. You know, we don't manage the customer. There's a different group of people that deal with the customer once, once he's in there to buy a car. But the handoff from sales to service is very poor. And, you know, the management of that entire customer lifecycle, whether it be in terms of referrals, in terms of other revenue streams that you can get from the customer, apart from service and spares, provided you can retain him in the network, but also referrals and, loyalty programs, replacing the car at the end of, the 3 or 5 year time that he keeps the car is also an area that needs a lot more attention, particularly in the B2C space and in passenger vehicles. And lastly, I think we need to move from being transactional to being more customer centric. So I think with just these opening thoughts, I'd like to, hand over to the panelists, and maybe I'd request Mr. Sahani to share a few opening thoughts around this whole topic of improving customer, dealer profitability through digital.
Thank you, Rakesh. First of all, a very warm welcome. I always enjoy coming to FADA sessions. And the topic today, which I see back there on the screen, is digital dealer. But I personally feel there's nothing called digital dealer. There has to be a progressive dealer. And the way things are changing in business environment, they're very, very fast. You know, the topic when I was shared that, I have to come here for a panel discussion for digital to help revenue and dealer profitability, I personally felt that actually in today's world, this topic is digital to help you run your business. You know, revenue profitability will happen, but if you today have to run your business, you can't ignore digital. That's what I feel. And if I have to give my opening remarks, I would only say, I'm in this profession for 22 years. And I know most of you, those who started your career very early. And those were the days in automotive world where most of the dealers used to say, my job is selling cars. Finance, somebody else will do. Then came an era where somebody said, no, finance I have to do, I need a desk. Insurance, somebody else will do. And then subsequently accessories and all. Our business, automotive business, is a very unique business. It's not like riding a horse. Our business is like riding a chariot, where you have 8 horses together. And each one of them has to run at a right pace, otherwise, we will lose, the race. So digital plays a very important role in making sure that we are doing business. Another thing which I was listening, all of us, when we talk about digital, we only talk about, how leads can be managed, sales. But I'll tell you, the most important thing is digital has to be a culture in your organization, because it's not sales only which gets impacted, it's after sales, which is very, very important. You know, when I see today, all of us are into this business for long. How many of you don't understand English? Aap mein se kitno ko English nahi aati? Just raise your hand. Not a single hand in this room. You know, so most of us are born in physical world and our language of communication is English. And we used to say, if you don't know English, you can't communicate, you can't run business. But the reality is, today's generation is born in digital world and their language is social. No more English. And if we are not connected digitally, even today, if I go out to any city and if I have to say, okay, I need to travel to this place, which hotel? TripAdvisor. I take always, opinion of TripAdvisor. Have to go to a restaurant? Zomato, what's the rating? Rating bad? Forget it. So it's not only lead management. I think, with digital, with social, the way today's generation is engaging social, as dealers, it's very difficult for you if you are not digitally aligned, making sure that you are managing your business very efficiently, riding the chariot very efficiently, it's going to be very, very tough. So that's how I feel about digital. To me, digital is not technology anymore. Digital is culture in the organization. It has to run from the top. Because I heard somebody saying, we don't get good digital people. I think the most important thing is, it has to start from the top. If you inculcate a culture, every person in your organization has to be digitally aligned. That's how I feel.
Thank you so much. Rajan, maybe you can share some opening thoughts.
Hi, everyone. So in my view, it would be an extension of what my colleague said. Clearly, actually, there's nothing called digital leader, because this term is so much into our minds. And when we talk about the lead management, of course, it is a different context. It is in a very different context. But when you talk about profitability attached to the digital, so-called digital leadership, it is nothing but the way the efficiencies you can add on to run your dealership. So let me walk you through a couple of items around the whole thing. You have a stock which you get from the manufacturer. This can be on a digital platform, which most of the OEMs are providing you. You need to get money from the bank to come into your system, which should take care of the requirement of getting the stock from the manufacturer. It is digital. Because you're looking at your current stock levels and you're ordering accordingly, and the money is available. Then comes the showroom. How many vehicles are there? What stock is there? That entire inventory management today is available on press of a button on your mobile. That is digital. Now, once the customer has come to the showroom, what is his experience? And what is the efficiency of providing that experience is digital. To reach out to the customer is digital, and for the customer to reach out to you is also digital. So this is an efficient entire chain which is getting around the automobile industry, and like all other industries, this is not left out. This is as much part of the overall evolution what we are seeing. In my view, your every sales manager, your every front-end guy, when it comes to the customer, has to be equipped and has to be knowledgeable enough to know as to the customer who's walking in is quite knowledgeable on the product features, on the comparison, on the comparative pricing and discount propositions, on the delivery. So he's completely aware. So you can't be just looking at the customer and say, sir, what do you want? It actually, that process, sales process is already started. So in my view, there is no need to have a separate team set up at the dealership that these are only going to look at the customers who will come through the digital platform. You might not be getting the lead. It might not have come on your platform, but the customer has acquired that knowledge before coming to your dealership. So if we look at around the entire value chain, and if you are able to bring in efficiency at each of this step, trust you me, it is all money. We are talking money here. We are talking about efficiency to close the transaction, which means faster churn of your inventory. We are talking about getting additional customers from the catchment area. It is efficiency. We are talking of faster conversions of the leads which have come into your showroom. It is efficiency. So the way we have to be ready for the evolving ecosystem, we have to see that wherever there is a customer, wherever there is a possibility of a customer being there, we need to have our touch point being created over there, either physical or digital. And hence it is very much required that as and when a customer needs you, may not be for buying the product itself, may not be for buying a car or a two-wheeler or a commercial vehicle, if he wants insurance, he should know how should he reach you. And this is the medium. He wants parts, he wants service, he wants anything which is so-called, you know, termed under the greater umbrella of allied services provided by the dealership. You know, it should be there. So both ways, that platform has to be available. Come to the efficiency, which we have spoken too much in the previous sessions. I think there is also a need, and more than the digital managers to sell the digital product, I think what is more required is somebody who's looking at the lead coming from any channel, be it digital, be it non-digital. But that conversion and the time to take for that conversion is of critical essence, and that is what adds to your bottom line. So my view is that it is how smartly, how efficiently you run the operations in this evolved world is actually, it all hovers around the so-called term digital, and we all are equipped. It at times it might require some stitching, at times it might require some association, some alliances with all the partners who have their core efficiencies into the required field. So once we have that, then we are fully geared up to cater to the changing needs in the market. Thank you.
Thank you, Rajan. I'd like to next request Mr. Vignesh, you represent the FADA Dealer Council. Just be interested in a, you know, dealer's perspective or FADA's perspective on what you are doing in the business as a dealer today. You've heard from both these gentlemen, you know, how we need a digital culture, how, you know, so many different touch points digital already exists. But what are you specifically doing? How are customers responding to those initiatives? And lastly, is digital helping you improve your profitability?
I'll answer your second question first in terms of profitability, because I think today's topic of discussion in this panel is profitability and how digital technologies can help us get there. When we came upon this digital dealer as a theme for this whole outer summit, we just wanted a thought process. That's probably the only reason the digital dealer is there. Digital dealer sometimes could be a misnomer in saying that, okay, we haven't digitized as of now, or digital dealer could only mean selling vehicles digitally. I think you, Mr. Rajan, touched upon the point, a holistic point, and how efficiencies in the dealership also can be garnered by using digital technology. It's very true. I work with two manufacturers. One is V Commercial Vehicles, one is Toyota. And in my perspective, they've been doing a lot in terms of digital sphere for the last 4 or 5 years. Not only in selling, but also, in, as rightly put by Mr. Rajan, in stock keeping, both in terms of inventory of vehicles and inventory of spare parts. Because these two are something which is very important. We save on that end, we pretty much make money elsewhere. Another place where manufacturers have also been very, very strong, as Renault is, it's recognized as one of the leaders in the Indian auto industry, at least in terms of digitization, is in terms of getting closer to the customer. In the other mediums of communication, be it paper, be it TV, be it radio, the shelf life of the communication is quite short. But when it comes to digitalization, having a website, being on LinkedIn or being on Facebook, the shelf life of this communication can be changed in accordance with times, according to the sales or according to the stock available with us, and the shelf life is largely longer. So overall, in terms of cost, in terms of profitability, this is the place where we need to. However, we have to achieve a balance. As a dealer, I also recognize the importance of physical space. So it has to be a balanced physical space for certain projections in terms of quality, in terms of touch and drive. But generally, I would, as a dealer, I would subscribe to the fact that we need to move away from higher dependence on physical space into more dependence on the soft space. It helps us in cost. Going to your first question in terms of we being available in the digital space, is that time right? Your first question.
Right. Your first question was around, you know, what are you doing specifically?
Yes.
And what do you see as the priorities? I mean, we heard so many things from lead management to marketing to sales traction.
To a large extent, lead management is something which a lot of our companies, our OEMs have already been good at. They've been working on it. As a dealer, probably where my role comes in is to develop my own content. As shown earlier by a presenter, more people tend to have hits on the dealer website rather than the OEM website. So in that perspective, we need to have more relevant data up there, something which we can communicate with our own customer. India is large. India is like the European Union. Every state has its own requirement, every state has its own nuances. It has every customer is different from state to state. So the dealers best them capture these requirements and also put it on the digital medium so we can address these requirements as and where required.
Last but not least, we have Sharad. Sharad, you've heard a few different perspectives here from an OEM, from a financial services company, from a dealer himself. So we have a large audience of dealers sitting here. You're a strategy expert. What should be the strategy, digital strategy that dealers should adopt in this rapidly evolving world? And are there any lessons that we can learn from other markets, other emerging markets, maybe China or any other market that you can share with us?
Thanks a lot. So I think the first thing, I think that maybe I'll take a slightly more different strategic perspective is to just step back a bit. Digital is one mega trend which is floating across the world. There are multiple other mega trends around this space, and I think it's very important to carve out digital perhaps in two parts to keep it simple. I think the first part where there's been a lot of discussion is what I would just call digitization of core processes. If you look across the spectrum of leaders, there are people who run lead management systems, who follow through customers, who do telecalling on their workshops extremely well, in the absence of some very core digital technologies. So the element of discipline and employer training does not change irrespective of which technology solution that you adopt. But I still think with the advent of this technology and this medium, there are opportunities to make this core process far, far more efficient than we've ever seen before. I think to me the more interesting observation really is what this technology offers in terms of solving problems which we've not been able to solve in the past. Let me take maybe three examples and broaden the spectrum, not just limiting it to sales and marketing for an automobile OEM, but stretching it across the value chain. Let's talk about finance. If you take a two-wheeler OEM, its biggest competition is the fact that 50% of its customers walk out of the dealer showroom because they do not have the cash or they do not have an established credit score on CIBIL when the bounce takes place to be able to buy the bike. Now, is there an opportunity for us to combine digital information which is not just limited only to an OEM or a dealer, but is available on social media, is available in other channels to actually completely change the way in which financing is offered to that class of customers. Second is, if you think about product recall or warranty costs or replacement cycles that customers encounter when a product goes into the market, there's a component failure, there's field quality issues. By the time that information comes back to the OEM, there is already a significant cost which has been incurred to the system. I think digital changes all of that. Today, and in more situations in the future, you will have cars embedded with IoTs, you'll have more and more information coming in from the market, faster cycle times in which OEMs will be able to respond back to a component recall or to a product failure. That's almost 3-5% of cost in the entire value chain which is sitting in that entire stream. So I think these are some areas where if one could apply their mind and work in a larger ecosystem of collaboration, one can really tackle 3-5% cost structures which exist, because these problems have not been tackled in the absence of today a digital medium. But I think it's very important to sort of keep the core process digitization and what is the new real world problem that you're solving through the advent of this technology and medium in mind.
Thanks, Sharad. So I'll throw a question open to the panel. Do you think the Indian automotive retail industry is lagging behind in terms of embracing digital? Do you think they need to move faster? Anyone can take the question.
Let's be specific here. I mean, in terms of systems and processes, I think if I can talk from my own experience as a dealer principal, in terms of what we have in Toyota right now, in terms of service, I think we have probably the best systems in the world. Probably we'd be the top three nations. I can only think of Japan being better than us, and probably Thailand being slightly ahead in terms of service, what are the process and system. But when it comes to digital marketing for sales, I think we have a lot of issues which we need to deal with. To start off, the whole issue about, let's say, having a service provider like CarDekho working along with an OEM and a dealer, To a large extent, the database available with the dealer is also proprietary to the OEM also. So that there is a clash right now, whether we can implement an independent service provider and whether the OEM is going to accept it because of data security, and also whether the dealer is, as Sumit put in, whether the dealer has the mentality to have the digital as part of his DNA. So these three have to work in. Some dealers, some OEMs are taking a leadership role, yes.
Okay, if I can just react to it. I think we have the best of the platforms available, which are at par with the market when it comes to the acquisition. While we have all the OEMs who are operating around the globe, so of course those systems are available. But in addition to that, what we saw of CarDekho and of course many other people who are aligned with it, we have different customers whom we face in our day-to-day life. Our customers demand not just a simple lead and its conversion. They want a complete value chain right from the time they have come onto the site. So they come onto the site to actually know about a particular product on a relative scale. But the demand actually does not end there. Then there is a requirement of what do they do with the car which they have at their home because they have to sell it. Then they need somebody to exchange that, which is going to arrange for margin money for them. Then they need the finance and the insurance. So around this ecosystem, the kind of systems we have, the kind of options we have available, I think are one of the best in the world.
You said, is the pace, we need to, you know, jump up the pace? Answer is yes. Everybody knows that. But when it comes to systems, I'll again go back to my earlier point. It is more of a cultural issue. It's like having the, we today have got one of the best digital platforms, and it's something like having the best gyms available, but you know, you have to go and exercise, otherwise things doesn't happen. And if I take a automotive manufacturer's perspective, we spend millions of dollars on our DMS system, millions of dollars. And our DMS systems, I can talk about my organization, we have recently invested a couple of million of dollars in bringing the new DMS system. And it has got tons of functionalities which can help a dealer become very efficient. But the point is, how much of that functionality are we using? And for that, again, it requires the message from the top. And as I said, digital is a culture in the organization. If somebody really brings that culture in the organization, Amit, you know, I heard Amit saying, you can't improve what you can't measure. And digital is something which really helps you measure everything and then do an analysis and take a decision. And I have seen most of you know, the dealers, those who are very successful, I haven't seen a single successful dealer, both on sales, after sales, customer satisfaction. A lot of time we talk digital only for sales and inquiry management. I haven't seen a single dealer who is not good on his systems, processes, DMS. It's impossible. So I think, yes, pace, you know, for sure, every time. At any step, you have to move much faster because the external environment is changing fast. So definitely, you know, it is required.
Sure, you wanted to say something.
I think the interesting thing about an automobile industry is, you know, you lie somewhere in between sort of what the consumer brands are there on one extreme and what I would call B2B classical industrial companies on the other. And therefore, in such a topic which is always, you know, innovating every day, there's an opportunity to learn on both sides. I agree with a lot of panelists. I think there's a lot of very core processes and systems which are already in place, which is there. But sort of two examples on either side that I would just quote, which are very interesting ones. I think on the consumer brands industry, like I talked about, you know, apart from digital, there are other mega trends. I think on marketing, a lot of the larger companies are moving away from mainstream marketing to starting to think about looking at advocates and looking at people who really matter when people are asking for a purchase decision. And for example, the example that we talked about, you know, if you want to make a trip, you go to, you know, one of the travel sites and get an opinion and review. And therefore, there's a lot of happening on the digital marketing side in terms of innovation on the consumer brand side. I think on the B2B industrial space, I think the big opportunity for automotive is really the entire aftermarket space. An OEM deals with anywhere between 15 to 30,000 SKUs on the aftermarket side. It is a high gross margin business for both the OEM and the dealer. And today, just given the breadth of SKUs to be managed and new technologies on 3D printing, etc., coming, I think there's a huge opportunity there to innovate, which players, you know, in the B2B space, such as a GE or a JCB or a Siemens, have already started, you know, moving towards.
So I'll throw one more question, and then we can take questions from the audience. So, do you think resource management at a dealership will need to change? I mean, from a skilling and training perspective, as we, you know, as we increase the pace, we adopt, you know, more digital interfaces with customers. We talked about the need for a better integration between the bit power and the horsepower, so the, you know, online world and the physical world. You know, will each dealership need a chief digital officer at some stage?
I don't think so. Here I would again go back to what Sumit said and how things have to be driven from the top. It's completely from the top. I mean, I'm a person who believes that even the HR head shouldn't exist in the organization, because HR should be a function of every person working there in terms of motivation and such. Going back to digital, you need not have a digital champion. Everyone should be moved to digital champions. The challenge is to move forward with mobility in digital. Whether it's available on tabs, whether it's available on your mobile phones, I think mobility is a question here. How we are able to convert a lot of our processes, going back to service, how we are able to, let's say, do an RO and AVAX together, walking around the customer with just a tablet or a mobile application, is available with a lot of manufacturers. It also goes back to whether other manufacturers are going to cooperate, and also the efficacy of how people are using it. Things are already available. There are great PMS software is available. Training skills is an issue. How do you train a manpower to handle it? How confident are they to go ahead and implement the process? So, yes, I don't think as a dealer principal, I require a dealer champion, digital champion in my dealership.
Okay, I would actually again divide it into two. As far as the acquisition is concerned, everybody at the dealership is actually a digital manager, because all the processes are going to run on some other platform to make it efficient. One aspect, however, is that when a dealer is using it as a medium to reach out to the customers, right? That, of course, that offerings, because that those offerings would also be changing from time to time. So sometimes it can be a campaign, sometimes it can be, you know, any extra offering going on, or sometimes it can be some area specific, some sector specific offerings. So that particular platform he will have to keep on changing, evolving. And the best suggestion to do that, and I have seen many dealers having created some digital platforms to reach out to the customers, or for the customers to reach back to them. The best way is to have an efficient technology company who's actually working for them and constantly upgrading. But at the same time, almost all OEMs provide that kind of facility to the dealers, or they at least provide that assistance to the dealers.
If I have to talk from an OEM's position, and when we go to our dealerships, one of the biggest challenge our industry today face is quality of manpower. Because unlike West, no young person, when he's in his school, has an aspiration to become a sales consultant at a dealership, which we definitely find in the Western world. So they are working at our dealerships in our business by default, because they don't have anything else to do. Most of them, I'm not talking everybody. And that's where our biggest challenge starts, because when we see one single brand having two or three dealerships in a city, not all three of them are working at the same efficiency. You will find one dealer who is like doing, who's having 50% of the share, and the balance two are sharing 25%. And if you go back and see, one of the key challenge for the balance two versus other is that the first dealer has got great manpower. And he's doing good business. But if we slice the manpower, actually there are two aspects to the manpower. And when I go to dealerships and I see, most of the sales consultants don't have good knowledge of products. And the way technology is coming, the way we are making changes, Knowledge is very, very important, and we manufacturers spend, again, huge money, millions of dollars every year on this, but the attrition is so high that the consultant will come and go. So when you hear a quality of conversation of consultant, the way he's explaining a product to a customer, sometimes, you know, you just hold your head like this. So I think digital and technology can play a very important role on this knowledge transformation. Because most of the time, and this is my experience, the good dealership sales consultants are very confident. You go to them, they will talk, you know, they'll have great knowledge, because knowledge brings confidence. And so that's why today, from an OEM perspective, we are putting a lot of money on technology. We don't want consultants to sit in a classroom and where we are training them. Everything should be on the app. So the guy doesn't have to spend too much of time. And in our business, it is knowledge about the product and the experience, the way you handle customer. I think we will have to focus a lot on the way our consultants are talking to customer in terms of behavior, in terms of experience, and digital can take care of the knowledge side. And these are, you know, tools which we should use to make sure that we have quality experience at our dealership. Customers today are very demanding, and you know, especially a customer who is coming from the digital side, you know, he has done his homework, and he comes to the dealership not for taking a decision. He comes to our dealership for ratification of his decision. And the moment he interacts with sales consultant and he feels this guy knows much less than I know, he loses his interest. So I think, again, going back to my point, it's very important for dealers to get aligned with OEMs, because on our side, we are spending huge money, investing a lot of money. Whatever tools we have, it is not the number of tools which matters. Selected tools, but make it, you know, used at your dealership. It's very important for you to drive efficiency, which at the end of the day will drive your profitability.
Thank you. So I think we can throw it open for questions from the audience. You've heard a range of views from an OEM, from a bank, you know, from a FADA dealer council member, and you know, from a consulting firm, or two consulting firms. So any questions you have around dealer profitability, any issues you think that we haven't covered, or you'd like to ask a question about? Can we have some microphones here, please?
Hello, good afternoon, my name is Pratik, I'm from Mumbai. So you just spoke about how the consultant should have more knowledge about the product, but I feel there is a lot of like sales consultants nowadays, they do not know how to sell. Knowledge of a product can always be acquired, and nowadays customers are more knowledgeable than the salespeople. But they are lacking the sales skills. How do you all, you know, how do you all cover that?
So, you know, if I have to talk about a young guy who comes to your dealership, who is not getting job anywhere else and he wants to come there, you know, knowledge is important, because when you say he doesn't know how to sell, it is because sales to me, car sales to me, or any sales, is nothing else but transmission of my confidence into you. And a consultant is not confident because he doesn't know how many, you know, what kind of features the car is having, what kind of technology is there. The moment the customer asks one question and he starts spluttering. So I think that portion, technology can help, because then everything is on your, you know, on your tablet, and you can explain, give a good demonstration. And more important is that, you know, then at dealership level, you spend more time in telling them how to handle customers. Because today, you know, in today's world, the customer is coming to your dealership well prepared. So he's going to ask you tough questions. Gone are the days when he's going to ask you easy questions. As I said, you know, he's not coming for making decision. He's coming at your dealership for ratifying his decision, whether what he thinks is right or not. So the knowledge level has to be slightly more higher than what we have seen in past. And he's looking forward to a very qualitative customer experience. Now, for a young, you know, team what we have, and the quality of people which we see at our dealership, you can't make them experts on technology, experts on customer experience. So I think we need to use a lot of technology to take care of certain hygiene issues, and then, you know, work with them so that at least they are giving qualitative experience to the customer. And whenever there is an issue on technology or more knowledge, they are well prepared, and they have you know, apps which they can use.
So knowledge is of course very important, but when we are talking about dealership profitability, we spoke a lot about getting a lot of inquiries from everywhere, generating inquiries. But I deal with a lot of dealers and sales consultants. There is the connect between the customer and the salesman is missing in most of the cases. Knowledge is there, of course, but that is the connect what I'm talking about. A lot of people lose out on their customers because somebody from the other showroom has connected well with the customer. You know, that's why even when everybody has spoken about leads, I think only Mr. Vikas Jain has spoken about how you should train your staff, how the people on the front line, the sales guys have to be trained, and not a lot of people paid attention to that. And for mostly all the dealers, I have been with a lot of sales guys, that is very important, I feel. So we should address that somehow. I don't know how you all will.
No, I think the way it is important, and this is how we have run our business, and it is important. So we have tools like DMS. If the sales head in the organization is using the DMS very efficiently, he will be asking the right questions every day. Why we lose a customer is because nobody asked that guy, what happened to these leads? You were supposed to go and give a test drive on so and so day. What was the quality of test drive? And nobody has a back end call center, again reconfirming what the consultant has done. So I think it's a ecosystem which needs to be there, and technology plays a very important role in this ecosystem.
I've been requested to close the session as the next session is waiting. So maybe we can take one last question. Somebody else had a hand up and then we can close. Can we get a mic over there, please?
Hi, I think this question or rather suggestion on my, this thing would be for Rajan. See, when we started this session, we talked about digitization. We said banks would be the first one to actually take advantage of this. Now, we as dealers work 7 days a week, whereas now banks have started closing, two Sundays. And as a result, a lot of, because of festive seasons and a lot of things otherwise, there are sometimes 3 days continuously when banks are closed. Now, isn't this inefficiency? Isn't this our money getting stuck? Isn't this a customer not able to getting delivery of the car because we don't have the payment for that?
So, excellent question, first of all. The banks and the dealer have to be working at a time when the customer wants you to work. So, let me first make a slightly bigger statement. Banks have various functions. Some of it are directly linked to the customer, and here I'm talking about your customer who's waiting for approval for a finance or who's waiting for approval, if not the disbursement. The banks have to be available, and I think that would be one of the differentiating factors. So at my current organization, the platform we are building, we are clearly and we are very focused on it that the customer will not come at a time when you want him to come. Alright? The customer will want you to be present when he wants, and that will be 24/7. Right? Now, whether you can service the whole set of customers who come to you within that given time frame, or you will be able to service 40% of them or 50% of them, would be a challenge, because that would be linked to what kind of credentials he carry. And let me give you a small example. Because of scarcity of time, I'll try to finish it rapid fast. You have biometric devices, you have various tools to check whether the customer is actually credit worthy or not. But if the customer falls into that segment, so even if it is at 12 o'clock, the approval system has to work and the disbursement has to work, and you should be ready to give him the delivery. May not be at 12 o'clock, but when your showroom opens, you have to give it. And that is the challenge. So I can tell you with utmost confidence that these are going to be the differentiating points for the banks in the days to come, and they do exist today. So the kind of platforms we are trying to build is to see that he comes online, and after the research he selects a car or a two-wheeler, and from there he selects a bank, and in case he meets all the parameters, the disbursement should happen. So these are the efficient platforms which are being worked upon.
Well, thank you very much, all the panel members. Thank you, audience.